The exhibition started with an invitation from Neme. They asked me to have a look at the way artists are exploring the new labor paradigm that is brought about by digital technology and how work is being transformed by technology, not only the type of work, but the kind of perception we have of what is work and what is not work and the way we approach it. I was already interested in the topic, and I was glad that this invitation came up because it allowed me to investigate deeper two facets of digital labor that I was very curious about. The first one is this emergence of a new type of precariat, and the other one was this myth that the machines, the algorithms, the artificial intelligence, whatever you want to call it, this myth that they are going to replace us, at least that they would make human labor completely obsolete. So we already know, of course, that digital technology has brought about so many positive things because it had enabled people to connect, people to communicate, people to fall in love thanks to the digital. And when it comes to work, it has also created new types of job. I would say that I could take myself as an example. So I train as in linguistics, more particularly in Latin and ancient Greek. And of course, when I was at university, I had no idea I would end up becoming a blogger and that it would become almost my full-time job. So that's how digital technology has transformed my working life. So yes, we know it. Digital technology brings a lot of good. And in the context of labor, it has also brought about a lot of precarity, and it has also enabled some companies to exploit human labor. If we think, for example, about the Uber drivers or the people who are doing food delivery, if you look closer, and I think they've been in the media quite a lot recently, especially since the beginning of the pandemic, but if you look closer at their daily job, there is on the one side the propaganda, you know, you're doing your cycling, it's exciting, it's sporty, and then you are an autonomous entrepreneur, and you're free, and you can do your own timetables and schedules. But in reality, all these people are really working at the mercy of an algorithm. They have to be ready all the time. They cannot work. I mean, it's difficult for them to work, for example, during the weekend or in the evening when they would rather be with their friends or with their family. And they have to answer very quickly to a proposal to work. And this kind of degradation of the working conditions can even go much further. And I'm living in Italy, so I'm going to give an example that I know a bit better. So in Italy, there is a word called the caporalato, and it's applied in different contexts, but in the context of the gig economy, you have in the beginning, when Uber Eats, when Deliveroo and all the food delivery applications arrived in the country, you had mostly young students or young professionals doing the delivery. And as the conditions degraded because the prices they were paid, the fees were just becoming lower and lower. Now, when you see the riders in the streets, they're mostly immigrants. And some of them are illegal. And if you're an illegal immigrant, you cannot apply to work as a food delivery worker. So the new phenomenon now is that someone who's Italian or someone who's been regulated will register with the food delivery platform, and then the illegal immigrant will pay a fee to that Italian person or to that people who's regularized. Either they're going to pay something like 20% of whatever they earn, but they're the one who will be doing all the job, would be doing the delivery. So you have this situation where the platform is already exploiting the human workers, but then human workers find a way to exploit people who are in a situation that is even more precarious than their own. And but we know about the food delivery workers and Uber, but something else I found very striking is the fact that this so-called Uberization of work, it now is more and more applied to a group of people who are, I think have always been in precarious situation, have always found it difficult to find reliable work and you know, make a living. And it's the people who work in the cultural sector, it's the creative freelancers. So now you have these platforms such as Fiverr, there are others, but you have these platforms where if you're someone looking for a logo, you're looking for someone to do translation, someone who's going to do a birthday video for your son, or something, who's going to do a business card, or going to do some voiceover as an actor, you can find these people on this platform. So the work of a creative freelancer is also part of the gig economy. And I'm giving the example of Fiverr because the name of the company, Fiverr, comes from the minimum fee you get. So the minimum fee you can get paid to do a logo or, I don't know, to do translation is going to be $5, of which the platform takes 20%. You can be paid more, but it starts at $5. So you can see how these creative workers, whether they are designers or translators or filmmakers, they're also seeing their work become more and more precarious, more and more atomized, more and more alienating, because they never get to meet their client. They just the only interface is this algorithm. And so you see how people who have completely different jobs, whether they deliver food or drive people or artists and designers, they have so much in common, and very often they don't realize it. They are part of what I see as a new type of working class. And there's one artwork in the exhibition, Working Towards Your Own Obsolescence. There's one artwork that really illustrates the problem of the working class quite well. It's a work by Liz Magic Laser, and the installation is called In Real Life. So it's a kind of reality show. And during 1 month, Liz Magic Laser followed five of these gig economy creative workers as they are trying to navigate the gig economy. So I think there is one who's a content creator, so she writes for blogs. There is someone who's doing some voiceover. There is a designer. And you can see how they like this opportunity to work what they studied for, or what they are passionate about, but how frustrated they are to be subjected so much to an algorithm and to have to answer immediately to an offer of job, to have really, really very tight deadlines. And the work is also showing how workers that live at the other end of the world, in India, in Bangladesh, or in an African country, they suffer from the same pressure of the algorithm, but they are quite happy with how much they are paid, because it's much better than what they would be paid for the same job in their own country. Whereas there is also at least one worker is from England, and she's also struggling with the same stressful conditions, but also for her it's much harder to make a living. Yes, as I was saying, the second topic that I was really fascinating about is this fear and this belief that we have that the machine or the artificial intelligence is going to replace us. And in a sense, it's happening. If you think, I don't know, for example, there are work that an accountant, very basic work that in the past maybe an accountant would do, and now you can have a software that does it quite adequately and cheaper and very fast. But so yes, the machines and automation, they make some work disappear, but they also create new ones, and works that are not necessarily very nice. And the other thing where artificial intelligence is applied is in work that already exists and in a way that is quite invisible. So for example, there's AI involved in hiring people, involved in monitoring the performances of the workers, in taking some managerial decisions, and also in firing workers. And yeah, as I mentioned, AI is also creating new not very, let's say, not very fulfilling work. So in order for an AI to be interesting and to be useful, it needs to be fed a lot of data. But the data has to be labeled, it has to be classified, it has to be annotated. And so far, the machines cannot do it themselves. So that's why there are human beings who are hired to do that. And they have fancy titles. So they can be called an AI trainer or a data analyst. But what they are going to do actually in front of a screen all day long, they are going to tag, to annotate the data. So for example, they are going to classify some images as being apple rather than pear. The example is a bit stupid, but also to identify where there is a vehicle on the road. And it's the kind of job that is very dumb, that is very repetitive, that is very annoying, and it's exactly the kind of task we were promised that AI would free us from, but it's not happening because AI at the moment cannot do this type of work. And so you have this data tagging factory where people do this kind of work all day long. So they not only have to train data, so to prepare really the data for the AI. There are also some jobs that consist in checking the data, so checking, for example, that a voice recognition system has understood correctly an accent. Simply checking that the AI has done a good enough job. And then there's a third category. It's both funny and tragic, but there are people who are paid to pretend that they are an AI. There's been example of services that were presented as being completely using artificial intelligence. So there was this service where if you were traveling, you would ask the application that was sold to you as being an AI. You would ask this application, well, I'm in this hotel, where can I eat if I like to eat Indian food? And it has to be this type of price. And in reality, it was a person who was behind the screen Googling and trying to find the kind of restaurant you were looking for. Yes, something I wanted to mention also, that's why some people call artificial intelligence. Actually, that's Jeff Bezos from Amazon when talking about his service, the Amazon Mechanical Turk, talks about artificial intelligence. Some people call it the human cloud. I quite like the expression Potemkin AI as a reference to Grigory Potemkin, who was this Russian military, was one of the favorites of the Tsarin Katarina of Russia. And he was sent to Crimea, just as Crimea has been annexed by Russia. And he was the country was devastated, so he had to whip it back into good shape. It didn't work as well as he had hoped. So when the Tsarin came to visit Crimea and see the fantastic job she thought that Potemkin had done, the legend is that he built this facade of villages, of really lovely villages. And he hired actors to play the role of, you know, the jolly, the well-fed and the happy peasants and shepherds. And so we don't know if it's true, but the term Potemkin is still used today in economics, in politics, or in any type of context where you have a facade and kind of a ruse or an illusion of something that gives you the impression that the situation is really good, but in reality it's rather tragic and quite bad. So that's applied to, in some context, to artificial intelligence. The title of the show, Working Towards Your Own Obsolescence, It's of course, it's inspired by the people who are working in these data tagging factories, who are training AI. And you have this idea that, you know, they're training AI and one day AI is not going to need these people anymore, so they will become obsolete. So that's the theory. I kind of have faith in humans, and I think we'll keep on coming up with data to feed to AI, and data that will just throw AI off balance, that will perplex and surprise AI. We will always need human beings to explain and train and classify this data for AI. But maybe I'm a bit too optimistic. So far I've painted what is, I suspect, a very dark and very worrying picture, but I think also I can observe that a digital technology has enabled workers to fight back. I'm going to give as an example the Turkopticon that is used by the Amazon Mechanical Turk workers to, it's a kind of plugin that they use to share tips and to tell each other, look, don't work with that employer, if I can call them employer, but don't work with that company or with that, that guy because they don't pay on time, they don't pay so well, the job is really boring, it's not described very well. And so there is a way for them to regain some sense of agency. And then they are of course cooperative, so there are platforms that also do food delivery or drive people from one side of the city to another, but that are owned by the workers themselves. So they basically copy the model of Uber, of Deliveroo, whatever, but they make it a cooperative where all the earnings are shared in a way that is much, that is fair, simply. And then there are little hacks. I really like this one. So Uber is what is called dynamic pricing. So for example, apparently when there is a concert on Friday evening, on Saturday evening, there's a lot of, there are many, many people who need a lift. So there's not enough drivers. So that means that the price of the ride will go up. And then there are times in the day, of course, where there are lots of drivers available, but not a lot of people who need to be going from one place to another. And so the price for a ride is going to be not interesting enough for drivers. It's going to be far too low. So they sometimes would collaborate to all each of them. They just switch off. They close the app. So the app of Uber will have the feeling, oh, there are a lot of people requiring a ride, and there is no one available. So the price goes up, and that's when the drivers come back on the app. They log in again, and so they accept the ride, and so they are paid better. And I really like this tiny ways to fight back. One last thing I wanted to mention is that there is humor in the works of the artists in the show. Behind me there is the work of Dasha Ilina. She's a Russian artist, very talented, and she created this fake company called the Center for Technological Pain. And she made first a series of objects that are tongue-in-cheek, quite absurd, super cheap, most of them are made of cardboard. They are open source DIY, and they address the kind of physical pain that we have when we are using technology a lot, which is what happened during the lockdown, during the worst moments of the pandemic, because we were many people, not everybody, but many people were home, and they had to spend a lot of time in front of the computer. And of course, the chairs they were using, they were not adequate to spend a lot of time in front of a screen, and people had neck problems, etc. So the work was developed before the pandemic, but I think it made even more sense since the pandemic. And for example, among the works that I exhibited, there are these gloves with little tips that are made to avoid the friction that you use when you're always on a keyboard and, you know, swiping or typing, so they avoid the friction of the tip of the finger. She also made videos that are based on self-defense, that so you would learn self-defense, this self-defense trick, but then when you see someone who's spending too much time on a computer or on his phone or her phone, you would practice this self-defense move, and so force, in a way that sometimes is a bit brutal, but force the person to come back in the physical life and abandon their device for a moment. There is also a very interesting, I would say even fascinating video by Stéphane de Goutin and Gwenola Wagon, who collaborated with a French philosopher called Pierre Cassou-Nogues. And the work is showing what our world would be like if the machines were doing all the work and humans would only be just having fun. And it's, the work is called Welcome to Erewhon. It's a reference to a book by Samuel Butler that was published in 1871 called Erewhon. And in the book, in Erewhon, people are living with machines, and at some point they realize that the machines are evolving in an organic way, just like animals and plants are evolving, but machines are evolving much faster and much faster than humans. So they decide to destroy the machines. And in the work by the two artists and the philosopher, you are in Erewhon, but it's 150 years later. And actually the machines are still there, but because they have been allowed to evolve so fast, they are doing all the work. And you can see that, you know, in theory, it would be nice not to do any work and only have time for our favorite hobbies. But then you realize that something is really would be really strange and off. And I think the video is showing that. And it's a kind of utopia. That's also an element I like, because usually when you talk about AI, you have all these dystopian works. And I like this decision to look into the utopia. And there's one last work I want to mention that has a lot of humor in it. It's called Twitch by, again, a young artist called Peter Bukowski. And what you do is that you're sitting on an armchair playing a video game, and you receive electric shock. In order to force you to play the game perfectly. And I think it was a fantastic metaphor to what is happening inside Amazon warehouses, where most of the workers, they have this scanner, barcode scanner, that also carry a display telling them where they have to go, which route they have to take, how fast they have to do the job. And so that's basically teleguiding them. And so, you know, I would end by saying that we were promised that artificial intelligence would be made to look like humans. And in many of the works that are described in some of the artworks in the exhibition, you see that actually it's the humans that are made to act and to behave more like machines.